Now we come to the ideal gas equation. After having said that there is nothing like an ideal gas, still we are hell-bent on forming an equation for the ideal gas. Okay, and we have said that under certain conditions, the gases do behave ideally. Even if they don't, and when do they not? When do they not? When the intermolecular forces come into play. So when we assume that the intermolecular forces are absolutely nil, then they are behaving ideally. If there is some intermolecular forces which are acting, then they will be non-ideal and the equation is bound to change. But, and under certain conditions, that is low pressure, high temperature, okay, when they have enough amount of energy so that any slightest of the intermolecular forces that they are feeling, that is overcome vehemently by the energy in the molecules. So in those cases, it actually starts behaving ideally. And even when it does not behave ideally, and the conditions are not extreme and opposite to the ideal, that means if you increase the pressure hugely, and if you reduce the temperature very, very, very much, only then they start deviating from their behavior. And if the conditions are moderate and they are non-ideal, still the pressures and the volumes and the temperatures that you are expecting will be quite close to what we'll be predicting by our ideal gas equation. Okay? But hold on. This is an equation that holds good for gases, yeah. The first thing. Okay, otherwise many a times I've seen students applying it for a solid or a liquid as well. Okay, and gases are an important part of so many chemical reactions or of so many important processes like the IC engine that you are operating. Right? So this gas equation becomes very, very, very important to understand any such process which involves gases. Okay? Now, till now we have laid the foundation of the ideal gas equation, and we have seen that if P is the pressure, V the volume, V is the volume, and T is the temperature, in Kelvin. Then we saw three laws, right? What? The first was V is inversely proportional to P, correct? V is inversely proportional to P, and this is what law?
This is Boyle's law.
So this is Boyle's law. Then V is directly proportional to T. This is Charles' law. This is Charles' law. Indeed, we also studied the Guy-Lussac's law, but that came from these two. Okay? So that is not as such an independent law, as independent as Boyle's and Charles'. And then came the greatest hero of all, the Avogadro's law. Why I consider this to be the most brilliant thing? Because it was an absolutely non-observable quantity. He was dealing with the number of particles. Fine? These people were dealing with things, the variables, which could be measured. The volume you can measure, the pressure you can measure, the temperature you can measure. Okay? Here he could measure the volume, but he had no way to know that the number, it is the number of molecules that are important, right? And as we saw, he actually brought together two laws, the Dalton's atomic theory and the Gay-Lussac's law. What was that? That was that gases, whenever they are consumed or produced in a reaction, they always do so in a simple ratio, right? So it was really so radical a thing that for about 50 years no one took any notice of it. Okay. So what does it mean? It means that combining the above, we get. What do we get? V is directly proportional to N G upon V. Okay? And for all proportionalities, we know that the sign of proportionality has to go away. So when it goes away, a constant drops in, okay, which is R. This is capital B. Okay. This is.
If we use Gay-Lussac's law, won't it be a different figure?
Which? No, he said that P will be directly proportional to T. If you keep the volume and amount constant. It's not. Mm-hmm. This will become more evident now. So where R is the universal gas universal gas constant, correct? This is called universal gas constant. Okay, and this is the ideal gas equation. Ideal gas equation. In fact, even more than this, it is this which is normally used. PV is equal to nRT. Okay? PV is equal to nRT. PV is equal to nRT. Okay? So it's how did they find the constant? The constant? Everything is measurable, no? So you put in a particular number of moles of a gas. Say if it is oxygen, you put in 32 grams of it, okay? Or if you cannot measure 32 grams, then put 320 grams of it. So that will be 10 moles. 320 is something that you can readily measure, right? So you put in 320 grams of this. So that is 10. The temperature is known. The pressure that develops is known. You can choose your own volume, right?
But they'll be doing it in non-ideal conditions, and why is it called ideal?
No. If the temperature is high and if the pressure is low, maybe if it's a very big container in which you are putting it, right? Say you are putting 0.1 mole of gas in 500 meter cube, then it's a very, very low pressure, okay? Then it starts behaving ideally. And see, it has come from the components currently, right? It has come from the components. So it is quite measurable, and you increase the temperature. Fine. In fact, we'll be doing that. We'll be varying pressure and see. We'll be varying pressure and see how nRT upon V or PV upon nRT changes. We will see that. Okay. So this is our equation. And when you are using the the ideal condition. So for example, we had said that at the standard temperature and pressure, the gases occupy so much of volume, right? So you can use that to find out this R. Fine. So let us see. We had said that at STP, the pressure at STP, the volume that was occupied by one mole of gas was how much? 22.4 or 22.4? 1 mole of any gas at STP. And what is STP? So what is STP? Which is 273.15 Kelvin and 1 bar pressure. 1 mole of any gas occupies 22.7 liter, okay? liter for an ideal gas. So I know V. So let us put it here. So what is R? My R becomes PV upon NT. What is my pressure? I'll convert everything into standard, right? So my pressure becomes so many pascals. So and it's a good habit writing the units. So P 22.7 liters is how much? 10 cube liter is equal to 1 meter cube, is it not? So 1 liter is 10 to the power minus 3 meter cube. So 22.7 liters, this is liters, okay? 22.7 liters is 22.7 into 10 to the power minus 3 meter cube. So this is 22.7 into 10 to the power minus 3 meter cube. Divided by the number of moles is 1 and temperature is 273.15. Okay. Now let us try to calculate that. Let us try to calculate it. Do we have a calculator? You have. So it is 8.310. So 8.310. Okay.
0.04. Now Newton per meter square into meter cube upon Kelvin.
Fine. Four. So they have used actually 22.71 liters, right?
22.71 liters.
You have used 22.7, it seems.
8.314.
22.7 divided by 273.15 is equal to 22.71 divided by 273.15 is equal to, it is indeed 0.8314 when you take this as 22.71.
So this gives you this. Now what is this? This is 8.314 and there is also a mole here. Mole is a unit. So, there is mole Kelvin. Now, you see, this will give you Newton meter per mole per Kelvin, is it not?
What is Newton into meter? Newton into meter is force into distance. And force into distance is what? Work. And what is the unit of work?
Joule. So, this actually becomes joule per mole per k, correct?
So r value is 8.314. Okay. So this is your STP that you use today. Earlier we used, so R values this. Okay. R values this.
Earlier, the STP conditions were were 0 degree centigrade and 1 atmosphere.
Now it is 0 degree 1 bar, right? Here it is 0 degree 1 bar.
So let us try to find out that. And there
it contained how much? 22.41 liters.
Okay. 1 mole of gas contained
22.41 liters.
So 22.41 liters of any gas.
Now use that.
So R becomes PV upon NT. Now your pressure is in atmosphere. So I leave it atmosphere.
Okay. I leave it as atmosphere.
I leave this volume, so 1 atmosphere into 22.41, how much? 3996 liters upon 1 mole into 273.15 K,
and it is so it is 22.41396 divided by 273.15. That gives me 0.20. Three double nine six divided by 273.15 is 0.08205746, right?
So it becomes 8.20.
What did we get? 8.205757
into 10^-2 liters atmosphere per mole per Kelvin.
Correct. Now don't get bogged down by these. Okay, so what I suggest is you use your 8.314 provided you are using everything else in SI units. Understand? We are using everything in SI unit. That means pressure in Kelvin. That's great. It's really fantastic. Pressure in Pascal, Newton per meter square. Volume in meter cube, temperature in Kelvin, and N in moles, then what you'll be having is this. You should be using 8.314, right? So 8.314 is the unit we should be using for all our purposes. Otherwise, you will find at least 25 to 30 such units. Liter, bar, per mole, per Kelvin, then liter, atmosphere, per mole, per Kelvin, meter cube. Okay. And it will give you a different kind of a value, right? So, and obviously shifted by something, right? So suddenly if you want to make it bar, then one atmosphere is about 1.01 bar. Okay, so 8.20 gets multiplied by say 1.01 to give you 8.20 this gets multiplied by 8.2057 into 1.01, so suddenly it becomes 8.28. Okay, so you'll find these things, but don't worry, they have all come from the same thing. But these two differences you should mark. Earlier we used to say that the STP conditions are these. Now we say that the STP conditions are these. Okay, fine. Yeah, so dyne has a completely different thing, no? It becomes actually gram per centimeter squared, right? For the pressure, and everything changes there. So cg a centimeter for length, and so it becomes different.